And so this morning I'm going into that second part very quickly, where I'm looking at this fact that we are in this beautiful season of Jubilee, and God is moving, and God is awakening His church. And God is moving into His church, and God is continuing to move through the hearts and lives of people across the nation. And God, imagine this morning, in the city of Jerusalem, in the nation of Israel, and there was this season, there was this time God brought them in, and God gave them the nations, and God would give them extended territory, and Moses and Joseph and all of them have inherited the promise. Joshua leads them in, and then he's allotting, okay, that area is for you, that area is for you, for this tribe, for this tribe, for this tribe. Divide the whole land by the people, and they all get into the land. Houses they did not build, farmlands they did not plant, for a harvest they did not sow. Everything is given. That is Jubilee. That is Jubilee. When you reap what you have not sown, that is Jubilee. And as you're looking at that position and everything that's happening over there, they take hold of all the blessings of God, and things sometimes still don't go right. Things still don't go right. And some of them are so, go up to the man and say, can you buy my land? Can you take my land? And someone else goes up and says, after a few years later, I've sold my land also, nothing is left. Will you take me as a slave to work in your field? Take me, take my house, take my kids, do something and take me as a slave to work in your field. And they would be working in that field and they would be doing different things. But then you look at it and Yeshua says, this is my kingdom. And I don't care what wrong moves you make. I don't care what the point of reference is where something has gone bad. I want you to understand, even while you're making a mistake, tell the guy who's going to be taking care of that mistake that his time on getting onto that mistake and benefiting from it is time bound. Tell him the year of Jubilee is coming. And the land will return to the owner. And the people that are working as slaves will go back to where they are, because our Jehovah God is the King of the nation. And I've said it before and I'm saying it again. I praise God that I have a chief minister, and I pray for my chief minister. I praise God that I have a president, and I pray for the president and the prime minister, and we love the men that God has placed over us. But I am also a man under a king. And while I have members of parliament, I am under lordship and I am under kingship. And so there comes a time when I have to choose between what one of them would say and what he would say. I will choose what the king says. Because the king is eternal. He doesn't get elected in and he doesn't get elected out. But every prime minister, every president, every chief minister, every member of parliament depends on somebody electing them. But me being a child of God has been dependent on the fact that He elected me to be a child, a son, a daughter of that living God. Hallelujah. Election here works differently. We are elected into that team, into sonship, in authority. And just think for a moment, if India had to be responsible to when the altar would be covered by blood and the trumpet would sound, and 4 million families stuck in bond and labor heard that sound of the trumpet. 40 million. 25 million children working in the acid shops, working in the Ulubati, in the Agarbati places, working in the granite quarries, working in the bricklands at 4, 5, 6, 7. And in India, the Christians prayed so much that a principle of Jubilee began to invade the nation of India. 40 million people would hear the sound of a trumpet and walk from bonded labor into the liberty of God. 25 to 30 million child laborers would walk into freedom of God. 7 million women in sexual slavery will say, "You can't touch me anymore." Can you hear the sound of the trumpet? Because the blood has finished its job. Think of those millions that will be walking through. The ones with the debt. And oh my goodness, a lot of the money lenders wouldn't like that festival in India. Things would be so different. Things would change. Captivity would just go away. And divorce and everything else, that the things that the devil steals away would be restored. Because there's kingship in our nation, and the king says, this is the year of Jubilee. And I believe somewhere you and I need to understand and catch a spiritual principle this morning. Hallelujah. We need to catch a spiritual principle this morning. Because your Jesus stood in the temple and he spoke in the temple and he said, "I'm here to tell you that the year of the Lord's favor is upon you. I'm here to tell you captives will be set free. Those in chains will be set free. I'm here to tell you that when Jubilee hits you, things will shift." And I shared with you a couple of incidences from the Old Testament believed to have taken place in those years of Jubilee. In those years of Jubilee, there was this man and he was sitting in Ur of Chaldees. And he probably would say, "Because of my parents, I worship the moon." But God came to the moon worshiper Abraham and say, "You will not stay in captivity to the moon, but you will come and worship the one that created the moon. Abraham, I break you free from that chain." Why are you sitting here this morning? Why are you and I sitting here this morning? Why did God choose our families from darkness? Why did God choose your family this morning? Somewhere the spirit of Jubilee worked through our homes and our families. And we are sitting here today. Oh, I praise God that I'm not worshiping so many other things that people worship. Because God sent Jubilee into my heart and into my spirit. I'm looking and I'm trying to see him. And Abraham is called and he says, "Abraham, look at the stars in the sky. Ur of Chaldees is not your inheritance, son. Nobody's going to tie you down there. Canaan is the promise I made to the others, and it shall be yours." And there was another Jubilee in which you had Moses coming. And he's out there in the desert. 40 years has gone by. I don't know how many times he cried to the Lord and said, "I lost it. I lost it all." I don't know how many times he fought with God and must have said, "God, you let me down. You didn't stand by me when I needed. I was a leader of people. I was a prince in Egypt. I had everything. Today I'm walking in the desert. I'm walking in barren land. All I need in this place is a group of sheep. And yet I had an inheritance over there." And I'm sure Moses must have had those moments when he grumbled with God. And I'm sure there was a time he said, "Don't you hear the cry of the people? They've lost, they have no inheritance over there." And God comes through the burning bush and says, "My son, take those shoes off. The ground you're standing in is holy ground." And some of the Jews tell us that it happened in the year of Jubilee when he went back. And he said, "Pharaoh can't deny your inheritance. You were born a ruler, and a ruler you shall be. Go to him and say, let my people go." And Pharaoh shall say, "It's not your people, it's mine. And you shall stand, and I will make you like a god to Pharaoh. And Pharaoh shall hear you, Pharaoh will listen to you." And in that year of Jubilee, you will walk out with those people. And Moses just wanted you to know, son, that their inheritance, what the locust and the cankerworm has eaten, they will walk out, and when they walk out, you will have not a group of slaves in the wilderness, you will have a group of millionaires in the wilderness. Everything that was robbed will be restored. And when you call for an offering, they will not be doing any empty transactions on mobile phones and giving you a couple of checks. They reach into their pocket and say, Uncle Moses, you can have some more gold. You want some more? Take some more gold. And Uncle Moses, in the middle of that wilderness, you'll have to tell them, your Jubilee's come. And guys, I can't deal with the overflow. For God's sake, stop giving, and I don't want to see any more gold. It comes when God's people begin to understand that the reign of the King of God begins when it is released over our lives. Whatever has been in the minus will overflow into the plus of our lives. Hallelujah. We know that what happened with Cyrus. We know what happened with Daniel. We know what happened when God said, hey, get let my people go, and everyone thought that they're going to stay there. And God goes to this pagan king in Persia. And says, Cyrus, anointing you just now, it's year of Jubilee, man. You better get across to Babylon. And when you get across to Babylon, your job is to let my people go. And Cyrus, when you get there, he comes into that place and he says, okay, tell me, we got to get these people to go, so what shall we do? He says, their gold is here. Give it back to them. Everything from the temple is here. Give it back to them. And Uncle Cyrus is saying, take the gold back. Take everything back. I want you to go back. Cyrus, you are building another nation except your own. And yeah, I'm about to do that. And he says, okay, you know what? Take some money, pocket money during the way for your travel. And you need to have some chicken kebabs along the way. You better take enough money for that also. And he picks up his mobile and calls his friend across and says, from Lebanon, can you send the best for the trees? And he calls the guy in charge of finances and he says, hey, you need to pay these guys wages when they go back and build the wall, and they begin to build the temple, and they begin, there's no one to pay them, so make sure, advance the money and send advance wages with them. Hallelujah. That's how the spirit of Jubilee works. Because Jubilee says the devil cannot hold on to your inheritance. There's someone next to you. The devil cannot hold on to my inheritance. He's got to give it up. Hallelujah. Come on, give the Lord a clap offering this morning. The devil cannot hold on to our inheritance. Key principles, I remind you, as we're looking at Jubilee, that it is rooted in this whole understanding of the blood of redemption. Once the blood was spilled, blow the trumpet, the blood has paid it all. It's covered and all. Key principle of Jubilee, hey, you are taking that man's land and you're employing him as a slave. Be in fear of God when you do that. Key principle in Jubilee. When you keep people in your house and they're working for you, and there are people working as your maids and doing different things for you in the offices where you work, in the homes in which you are, remember there is a God when you deal with them. Be careful of the wages you pay to them. Be careful. Whoever works for you, be careful when you're setting the terms of employment. Remember, there is a God. A key principle over there in Jubilee is always remember that the king is the owner of people and lands. The earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof. Don't buy and sell like you're the ultimate king of it all. The house you buy, the car you buy, every possession that you have, God is the owner. Hallelujah. God owns everything. We're stewards. And the only thing that you and I carry in our hands is the cross on our back and the anointing of the Holy Spirit in our hearts. Hallelujah. And there's greater conquest to be made in that. Jubilee continues to affect us. And he says, every time someone comes to you, remember that Jubilee is not just operating on that 50th year. Jubilee is, live your life every day. This farmland I have taken from that man, and let it haunt you all through the years. Even if you took possession of it in the first year, say only 49 years, and there's a reference point to redemption, there's a reference point to the freedom of that thing, there's a reference point in which God is working, and God expects all of us to work with a reference point, then everything must go back into the nature of equilibrium that God has in store for us. And there's a strong thing that's going out there. I'm going to leave you. I asked you to read Leviticus chapter 25. And I'm going to quickly bring you a few points and then close in prayer this morning. But receive it into your spirit. Jubilee cannot be caught in your mind. You can have an understanding of it, but if you don't catch it in your spirit, you're not going to operate out of the spirit of Jubilee. You're not going to operate out of it. A couple of teachings for us from the book of Leviticus. But here, there in Leviticus chapter 25 and in verse 10, this is what is written there. And you shall hallow the 50th year and proclaim liberty throughout the land unto all the inhabitants. It shall be a jubilee to you, and you shall return every man into his possession, and you shall return every man unto his family. The trumpet's going to sound. Proclaim freedom. Proclaim freedom. I don't know about you, but I'm sure for Matthew and for Suha and for all of us that have been working with human trafficking and so many, all those things that has become part of us at First Assembly of God Church. I don't know about you, but this cry of Jubilee, it's been coming upon our hearts, it's coming upon our spirits, it's been coming upon us over and over and over again, that the Lord our God wants us to pronounce over the length and breadth of this land, from Kashmir to Kanyakumari, from Mumbai into Northeast India. God wants us to be able to carry to the people and say, Jubilee and freedom is available by the blood of Christ in the name of Jesus, and there is no chain on it. There is no bondage. There is no man. There is no mafia. There is no one. You see, if we enforced it, the land would receive it. But so many times we're enforcing prosperity. We are enforcing the decorations of life. We are enforcing what is needed for today and gone for tomorrow. And the devil's got the church busy. And people have been busy enforcing the temporal instead of enforcing what is eternal and what is spiritual this morning. Church of Jesus, Church of Jesus this morning, let me ask you this morning, even as we stay in God's presence, you and I must understand that slavery God detests. Being in bondage to whatever kind of bondage it is. Bondage to alcohol. Bondage to pornography. Bondage to a certain way, to the TV, to the entertainment, to something else in the industry around you. Bondage to a mindset. Bondage to a culture in the world outside. Bondage to a pop culture that is in the city, one of the highest. We cannot sit and watch Bangalore City in bondage to being called the pop color, pop city of Asia. We can't sit in a city that has been called today the heavy metal capital of India. We have a responsibility to see that bondage is broken. We cannot sit in a nation and say, I find everything is okay, when we are the second highest in suicide. What are we Christians asking for? Is there an enforcement that's coming from you and me that's saying, under my watch, the city will not be second highest in crime against women? Under my watch, this city is not going to be called the hub of human trafficking. That's going to go. Because under my watch, the word that the freedom of God is reigning all across my city and my people, in the dungeons, in the bylanes, in the slums. How can it be that 2 children will die every minute of hunger? And yet you and I believe that there is a year of Jubilee. How can it be? How can I be praying for another brand of Maggie noodles when someone dying of hunger? I'm looking at my house and I see sometimes my children just wasting their food. And in the 10 minutes that they sit at the breakfast table, 20 children will die without food. We would say, don't force them. Don't do this, don't do that. When you sit at your breakfast table, when you sit at food, when I sit with my colleagues in the office, is there a spirit of Jubilee inside us? And something's burning inside you and saying, let freedom reign. Can you say those words just now? Let freedom reign. There are people enslaved to the law and to the lawyers and to divorce and to all these things, and the devil is coming to steal, kill, and destroy. He has only 3 points in his agenda. It's time that someone in the church cried out for 7 children that will die in this 1 minute being aborted in the womb in the nation of India, and says the womb is no longer under captivity to a spirit of abortion, but it is under captivity and liberty to the spirit of life in Christ Jesus. Hallelujah, somewhere. Doesn't my church, do these things touch you? Or is it enough for you to pray for your children? And as long as God has blessed your children with a job, and blessed my 2 children with good college, and blessed my 2 children with good education, will it be enough? Is it enough? And somewhere I'm telling myself, my mind is under captivity and slavery to the things that I see only necessary for my children and my family and my own well-being. I'm selfish inside. I'm selfish inside. I'm selfish inside. When I am a carrier of liberty, that God says, Anthony, speak it all over the land. Speak it in the places they haven't heard it before. Let freedom reign. Let freedom reign where people never ever believed they could be set free. Where chains has become the accepted culture of life. Caste is holding people captive. Drugs, alcohol. And yet for many of us, we're still struggling how to handle our mobile phone. We're still struggling how do we handle the 1 hour of surfing on with the internet. Hey, listen, turn to somebody next to you and say, do you know what you got? Do you know what you got? Do you know what you got? You are somebody that is witness that there's blood on the altar and it is done. And over 100 million people in our nation that need that freedom. My eyes don't see beyond my own house and beyond my own home. And so my prayer, it dries in 2 minutes. My passion for God is about 2 hours on a Sunday morning. Church, church, the blood of Jesus is on you this morning. Hallelujah, somewhere. Hallelujah. As your family, does everyone in your family know there is freedom today? Does everyone in your office know that the blood is shed and there's freedom today? There's the people down the road know this freedom. Have I prayed freedom? Because that's what he said. When you pray, thy kingdom come. And when the kingdom comes, Jubilee comes with the kingdom. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Jubilee comes with the kingdom. And there's freedom across the nations. There's freedom across the lands. There's a slavery that is worse than what was seen in the centuries before when the Negro slaves were brought in. That slavery is nothing compared. Oh, we think that we can point a finger at somebody else. Stop looking at the speck in somebody's eye when 100 million people in this nation are in worse forms of slavery today than the world has ever experienced before. 7 million girls will be raped at least 20 times today. And your newspapers will have the report of one or two of them. And God saying, you know, I rejoice with the message of slavery, but I'm also burdened with it. I'm captivated by it. Because the message of the year of Jubilee, hallelujah, the year that God is going to give back, the year when freedom will reign. I'm not going to be selfish and say it's good enough for my family. Oh, my son is saved, my daughter is saved. Something burns in my heart because there's a nation that needs to see the liberty and freedom of my God. Are you with me this morning? And if you believe you have responsibility to them, will you lift your hand up this morning? Pastor, I have responsibility. There's 100 million in my country that I have responsibility for. I have responsibility for them. I have responsibility for them. He says in Leviticus 24:50, he says, If thou sell aught unto the neighbor, or buyest aught of thy neighbor's hand, you shall not oppress one another. Don't oppress. It hit me like, it just hit me out of the blues. Look at that. I think we've got an ESV version over there. You and I will never be able to celebrate this festival of freedom and liberty when we oppress others and people in our own houses, staff in our own church, people in our own family, maids working in our own houses. Are you catching what I'm saying? Do not encounter freedom, but encounter oppression from us. Is there a place of honor for those that work in your home this morning? Is this a place of freedom for those in your team this morning? I'm team leader, Lord Pastor. God gave me the promotion. You know what? When God gives you the promotion, God is promoting everyone in the team under you. Because if there's a man of liberty at the top, liberty and freedom will reign upon that entire team that's placed under the leadership of that kind of a leader. Hallelujah, this morning. And I keep looking and I keep saying so often, I keep telling my staff, I said, you know what? I don't want first aging to be for our staff something like working in the Maruti company. You can work in the Maruti company or you can work in that Audi and BMW company. and you're a worker, but you dare not touch the car. You are never qualified to touch the car. You are never qualified to use the car. If there are people working out with us in First Assembly of God Church, praise God, three of our workers were baptized, came to the saving knowledge of Jesus, and that's what it's going to be in the culture of First Assembly of God Church, that we will first take freedom to the people that work with us before we bring them a salary. Hallelujah. One of our boys came from a Hindi background, was saved over here. He's with us just now. He says, I want to become a minister of the gospel. I know it's going to happen one day. I hope it happens quicker than later. Beloved ones, you are a carrier of freedom. And in your promotion is the promotion of many. Tell somebody next to you, in your promotion is the promotion of many. No, I don't like that. I want to go up the ladder only alone by myself. Get used to a different culture. There's a lot of space at the top. The world, the devil says it gets narrow at the top. The devil says it gets narrow at the top. But when Christians are there, it gets broader and wider, and there are beautiful things happening at the top where God has His people positioned this morning. Speak freedom. The year of Jubilee is a year of freedom. Tell someone next to you, the year of Jubilee is a year of freedom. When chains are broken, oppressive forces are broken, and people are brought into the freedom of Almighty God. And you remember that verse in Galatians chapter 5 verse 1. It is for freedom Christ has set you free. Therefore do not be burdened with the yoke of slavery. Not in your workplace, not in your house. Do not be burdened with another yoke of slavery. A second thing very quickly this morning, as I look at it again, 25 verse 10, and he says, and he's talking again about people returning over there, look, returning, and I'm reading it right up the screen just now in the ESV, and you shall consecrate the 50th year. Can we all read together? 1, 2, 3.
And you shall consecrate the 50th year and proclaim liberty throughout the land.
It shall be a jubilee for you. Each shall return to their property. Each shall return to their families. Hallelujah. There's a powerful word over there. Nothing is irreversible. Everything shall return to a place of blessing that the Father had in store for it. Hallelujah. There's a return. There's a restoration that takes place. A return to possession, a return to family. The enemy of our soul, I said it, he keeps saying, I've come to steal, kill, and destroy. And Jesus says, you know, it's year of Jubilee. Hey, Kevin, he's coming to steal, kill, and destroy. I have come that you will have more and more, and have it more abundantly, and have it more abundantly. And the problem with the spirit of Jubilee is not a problem of having to struggle with limitation. It is struggling with having what is more abundant. Yeah, tell someone next to you. It's struggling with having more in abundance. That's a struggle. That's a struggle with Jubilee. It turns everything upside down, beloved ones. Listen to me this morning. Jubilee turns things in our lives upside down. In the season of Jubilee, I've had people here come to me in the last 2 weeks and say, Pastor, they were firing guys from the office and the letters of termination were going out here and there. And I was trying to get out before they terminated me. But then I decided I would just let God do what God has to do. And last month I was called and I walked into the cabin. And he says it was like walking down the death walk. And my boss looked at me. And my boss said, you've just been promoted, young man. And it's so easy to come and to give a testimony that I just got promoted and my salary just got doubled. And yet God's looking at you and me and saying, hey, not just for you, the return is going to be for many. The return is going to be for many. And in the year of Jubilee, there's going to be those encounters when there will be restoration. Something that the devil has touched in your family, believe it just now, that God is going to restore that. Claim it just now. Hallelujah. I hope I hear somebody claiming it just now. Claiming it right now. This is going to be restored to my children. This is going to be restored to my family members. There's a restoration that's coming, and it's going to happen in my home. It's going to happen. You know, Satan wants to keep you from the best. He will do everything to keep you from doing God's will. He wants you to stop from going back to your possessions and having all that God desires you to have. Satan does not want you to have it. And Jubilee says, God says, you will have it. He can't hold the inheritance back. He can't hold the blessings back. There may have been a time, there may have been years, and someone sitting here, I'm talking to many of you just now. You say, in that year I got the prophetic word. Pastor, this year in the beginning I got the promise. And something has not yet happened, Pastor. I'm still waiting. In the name of Jesus, I tell you just now, if you walk in the spirit of Jubilee and there's real freedom inside of you and you don't oppress others, but you bless others. Guess what I'm saying just now. If the mind is locked up, you cannot carry the spirit of Jubilee. If the mind is locked up, you will never be able to be a bearer of the spirit of Jubilee. Your spirit needs to be open. Your heart needs to be open. And if our minds and our spirits are all caught up, and there's no returning to restoration, then you and I will never be able to see the spirit of increase. He says, first, proclaim the liberty. And secondly, he said, make sure things go back and they get restored. And God was speaking to me about that. I haven't yet told my wife, I can tell her now. Whatever we have lent to somebody else will not come back to us because we carry the spirit of Jubilee. We shall not look at people. We shall not look at others who have borrowed from us. And every time we see them, oh, this guy didn't borrow anything. You see what happens when you begin to do that and say, I borrowed from somebody. And every time I see him coming, I want to run the other way. And somebody's coming towards me and he reaches me, somehow grabs me around the corner because I can't run out of the church premises. And I look at him and in my mind, well, this guy's worse than the lion. This guy's worse than this. This guy's worse than that. Inside my heart and my spirit, I'm speaking evil over him. You see, when you don't release people, you begin to inherit what they speak over your life. You begin to inherit the words they speak over your life. And you're wondering why you're not getting your release. It's year of Jubilee. Release the people that owe you thanks. Release it. Because God's about to bless you. The Bible is such a summit that you can go into a house and the Bible says, well, when you go into the house, if they receive you, you say, blessings be on the house and blessings will be on that house. But if they don't receive you, come outside. Dust your shoes well. You don't want to carry the remnants of a grumbling, mumbling, wicked spirit to where you are going. Are you hearing me this morning? You need a spirit of Jubilee. Because God cannot bless you if you're still holding somebody else's credit against them. Are you catching me this morning? It's a hard one. Church, it's a hard one. Say that's a hard one. It's a hard one. It's a hard one for me too this morning. I would like to go back and collect not the little pieces that I have lent. But I'd like to go back and collect all. I said all. that God had in store for me even before the foundations of this world. Come and shout hallelujah, somebody. You got to make a choice. The conscious spirit, we like that word, conscious, keeps holding on not to big things, usually to small things. It holds to small things. And it's never open. It never says freedom. It never says my growth is in freedom. It's selfish. It's always selfish, 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 selfish. It wants to hold on. 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 But a freedom, a spirit of jubilee is an open spirit. It says, bring restoration. Let there be restoration. You are passionate not to collect. You're passionate to release. You're passionate to see restoration. And when you catch the spirit of jubilee, people around you and me begin to catch that spirit of restoration around us. Hallelujah. 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 Okay, continue to look into that, to that whole understanding that is there. Not only is it the spirit of freedom, not only is it the spirit of restoration, when things will return back. Thirdly, it is this, in chapter 25, verse 12. Can you go to verse 12 for me? Can we read 1, 2, 3? For it is a jubilee, it shall be holy. Can you repeat that? It shall be
holy.
It shall be
holy.
I don't like the way they preach it on God TV, because it becomes a very unholy thing. It's about greed. It's about lust. It's about, you know, all this kind of abundance. But I want for you and to me to understand, it's a spirit of freedom. It's a spirit not only of freedom, it's a spirit of restoration. Restore others and God will restore you. Hallelujah. Restoration. Not only is it a spirit of restoration, jubilee is a spirit of holiness. Say it's a spirit of holiness just now. It's a spirit of holiness. It says, it shall be holy to you. You may eat of the increase of the produce of the field. Sticker, just take this other one for me just now. Chapter 25, verse 21, that goes in line with this. And look at this verse 21 just now. Let's read it together. 1, 2, 3. I will command my blessings on you in the sixth year so that it will produce a crop.
Sufficient for 3 years.
A crop for?
3 years.
You go to your boss, you'll get 10% increase in salary. But there are times when God's Holy Spirit moves and the Word of God says, how would you like, I don't know about you, but you know, when I get a bonus, if you examine my mind, the list of stuff in my mind is 3 times bigger than my bonus that I'm getting. And I love what God says. Beloved ones, receive it into your spirit right now. Receive it into your spirit. God says 3 times bigger. In 1 year, you will get what you had in 3 years. And I've seen it, I've tasted it, I've experienced it. When God presses something, shakes it together, presses it down till it's full and running over. And I've seen that so many times in my life. At the age of 50, I've had 4 vehicles so far, and neither one has been bought by me. I've never bought one of them. I done a PTH as a single student, and then went on to do a BE for 3 years with one child, then went on to do a PTH with 2 children. And I never paid the fees. I never paid the fees. Because my God was faithful. And jubilee comes with us, and God says, I can just, you know what? When jubilee comes, you won't be drinking out of that Nandini skimmed milk, you will be drinking out of the condensed milk. Everyone will be watching around you. And I believe the life of every Christian, the life of every Christian must be a picture of overflowing of the condensed milk that is coming from our God's throne. You will catch it. You will catch it. You will catch it. And this is such a beautiful teaching over there. He says, your problem, Moses, is not going to be where can I raise the offering from, but you're going to tell the people, please, I humbly beg you, do not bring any more gold or silver. Because Jubilee has hit the people of God. And then so they give so much of gold and silver. You see, that's the liberal spirit in people that are in Jubilee. They give. And so then they're reaching the promised land 40 years later. They probably don't have much to give. And so they're reaching there 40 years later. And God says, come on, guys. I know your pockets are empty. It's time to fill them up again. And so cities they didn't build. Houses they didn't build. Farmlands they didn't plant. Everything gets ready. And then Uncle Solomon says, I want to build a temple. And again Uncle Solomon has said, please stop bringing any more donations for the temple. Where did they get the money from? Where did they get those finances for? You see the spirit of Jubilee? It's got open hands. It's got open heart. It activates the blessing. It just lets it flow. It's not a spirit in it. Okay, this time I'm going to get for 3 years or so. I know how much my bank balance is going to go up. And the God is coming. It's not a selfish spirit. It's abundance with a spirit of holiness. Abundance with the spirit of holiness. That's what God has for us. And so it's not only the spirit of freedom, restoration. It's an abundant spirit of holiness that's moving in us. And finally, he says in verse 18, he says, you will dwell in the land with all safety. You will not have to go to bed terrified at night like Anil Ambani and Mukesh Ambani and all these guys. And they have this 10 guys and 100 security cameras and living in constant fear. You can go lie on your bed and you can enjoy it. Oh, I remember that time I was coming back on trade. Sunny and me, we went to the SIAG conference and we were coming back. And so we got into the Shardapti. He got into the corner. I got into the center. And in seconds, Sunny was snoring. You know how Sunny snores. And so Sunny's gone. And then a lady came and sat beside me on the other side. And she kept looking at me. And I'm saying, God, waken Sunny, this lady's up to something here. And I'm pushing Sunny, but Sunny is snoring so loud, the next 10 rows back, you can hear him. And then she started talking to me and said, we have so many crores of business in Jamnagar, and so many crores of business in Bihar, and so many crores of business in Chennai. And we want to do some more business in Bangalore, and we want to get into Mumbai also, and we're willing to invest so many crores of business in Mumbai. And I'm wondering, why is she talking to me about so many crores? Because the only crow I know of is a black one. And then she's leaning over, and she's finding me not responding. And she said, you look like Anil Ambani. I said, sister, I sleep well, I get up well, I enjoy life well. Thank God I am not Anil Ambani. There will be blessings. And with the blessings of the Lord doesn't add sorrow, fear, tension. It adds joy. Hallelujah. It adds security. It adds all those beautiful things that God has in store for us. And if we are saying this is the 70th Jubilee, if we are saying this is the most amazing Jubilee, if we are saying this is the one that you need to really look after and watch after, beloved, in this year, bondage to failure, enslavement to oppression, servitude to sin, those that are enslaved to sinful lifestyle for so many years, don't go back to those reference points. Create a new reference point just now. A reference point that says, I have been hit with the year of Jubilee. You see, Satan chains us. And we make the reference point, if only I listened to somebody in seventh standard. If only I'd done this in the 10th grade. If only this didn't happen to my dad. If only I was born next door to Brother Mark in the United States of America. If only I was in another nation. If only I was in medical school. If only I was an engineer. And we so often look at our lives and there's an if only that you refer to as the reason why you cannot go forward. Are you catching what I'm saying this morning as I'm closing? I'm speaking into your heart just now. You have an if only, and you know, you're kind of like the cow that's saying, oh, I'm eating all the grass. But there's a central peg that the chain is tied to. And you can never go beyond that and eat on the other side. And you say, if only. If only my father didn't die. If only my parents didn't break up. I wonder if Esther had to say, if only my parents were here. And God says, Esther, Papa's not here, Mama's not here. But Lord, I have plans for you. Want you to marry the king. Want you to marry the king. If Joseph had said, if only I'd gone to college. If only I was born the eldest. And David said, if only my dad turned me into a veterinarian doctor instead of looking after the sheep. At least that would have been better. What is your if only that puts a lid on your life this morning? What's the if only? If only my family was better. If only my spouse was a little more understanding. Hey, listen. Break those chains of reference. Go back into your house. Do not say of only. Begin to speak and prophesy over your house. Begin to pray over your family. Begin to pray over your loved ones and say, this house is under the liberty of the year of Jubilee. There are no if onlys, ifs and buts in what God wants to do with me. There are no ifs and buts. I can give. I can freely receive. I can freely give. I can be like Colgate, who struggles to take 0.1% of his salary. He struggles with it. The guy with Reynolds pen struggles to take 2% of his salary. It's too much. It's too much. I hope you're catching in your spirit something just now. God has prepared the spirit of Jubilee for you and for me.